So we went together at a celebration and told ourselves that we cannot have two candidates from Southern. What we have to do is Southern. We have to go together with one candidate and make sure that we elect him. So we elected. This is just to give you a background and also history of where we have come together, the youth of Zimbabwe. So, coming to this activity, first, I was in the south of the Democratic Republic of Congo, known as the east, that's Lubumbashi. Lubumbashi is 1.5 hour flight to Harare. It's raining. You can drive, if you leave early in the morning, Harare, in the evening, perhaps you can reach Lubumbashi. So we are very close. This forum is important because its objective is to bring together the young people of all the tendencies. The young people from the ruling party, the opposition, and the civil society. Because what is important for Zimbabwe youth is first Zimbabwe. When you are born, you are not born as Zambia. You are not born as MDC and all the other parties or independent as honorable. You are born first as Zimbabweans. And that's what needs to come in the mindset of Zimbabwe youth whenever you think about this country. What is more important in Zimbabwe than the political parties? What is more important in Zimbabwe than your tribe? What is important in Zimbabwe than your promise? So coming here, I say, what am I going to say to Zimbabwe? Have attended so many events, youth events in the world, and I'm not tired because I'm retired. I've been living flights going all over the world. So when I was sitting, I was saying, what should I tell the youth of Zimbabwe? What message am I going to carry to these young people of Zimbabwe? And I saw a regular speech written by my office, printed and given to me. I looked at it and I told myself, there's nothing on this speech that it is safe. I need to be very real and be able to give the needed message. Now what you need to understand is that the future of this country depends on what the country does to the young people. When you see a young people of Zimbabwe, you can determine the future of Zimbabwe. And when we talk about the future of Zimbabwe and the youth, we see four important pillars of youth development. Access to quality education, youth participation in decision making, youth access to health, and also youth entrepreneurship. When you talk about youth participation in economic sector, you see youth access to finance. 60% of African population, more than 60% is composed of young people. And 60% of unemployed Africans are the young people. And this is very dangerous. This is a big threat to African security in our countries, and the young people that are unemployed are mostly manipulated politically. And this is the young people that threaten the security of our countries. When a young person works in the morning and he doesn't have anything to do, for 30 30 years, for 30 days, that young person will come up with something to do. And somebody might play and manipulate the mindset of this young people. Professor Muyumba said yesterday that the danger of Africa, mostly the educated people. When uneducated people sit down without being anything very dangerous. So access to education must be a priority, and we have to make sure that we have free education. When we have free education, this can enable any child to access education, especially the girls and the young women. We have almost 120 million young women out of school in the world. And 50% of that are in Africa. So the future of a young African woman is not certain. So education is key, because without education, I will not stand in front of you today with you. Without my degrees, because I have two anyway, I'm proud of that, I have a law degree and I have a communication degree. So because of that, I'm able to come here and talk. It is not my appearance as Francine Muyumba that I'm being able to do what I'm doing today. It is what I have in my head that enabled me to go everywhere around the world and say something. And as a woman, to sit on the same table of the decision making with men, because I have something to offer in my head. I don't walk up and just say, because I'm a woman, I will comb my hair like this, I'm going to put nice earrings, and I'm going to dress well, then I'll be accepted all over the world. Not at all. But because I am a woman and have something in my head, I'll say something and I'll respect it. And this is a main challenge of so many young girls that I'm seeing here. Education must be a priority. Not any languages. After degrees, as your first husband. And the husband you love, the person you're going to love will be your second degree. Yeah. Being a woman is not just to know how to put some makeup on the face. Being a woman is not to look at your physical appearance. Being a woman is also having the ability to also know who you are intellectually. My father always said, and this is why I get where I am today, because I have very tough parents, that when you are a woman, you must always ask yourself a question. Am I different from a man? Is a man more important than me? And for my father, when you go to school, you are not in the first 5 best of the classroom. My father asked me how many times those was eaten a day for them to be first 5. And you are not part of the first 5. So if you don't have that food, I will give it to you. So that means, as you sit as a young woman here, as a girl, you need to know that nothing is impossible. No matter where you are in your region, I grew up in a very remote area. Nothing is impossible for you to accomplish your dreams. No matter where you are, no matter where you are coming from, nothing is impossible for you but with education. Be careful having bad friends. When I was a girl, I was very careful. You need to make sure that you have friends comfortable for the good ones and the bad ones. And things that can align with your dreams, things that can help you to progress, things that can enable you to think big. So for the young girls, for the young women, I have a problem, I've come from somewhere, and I've worked very hard. Honorable say, I started in the Student Representative Council at the University of Miami as a foreign student. It was very hard for me to speak English because I was coming from a French-speaking country. I had some friends from Zimbabwe because there are so many friends in the University of Miami from Zimbabwe. And I taught a friend of mine that, listen, I want to become one day the president of the Student Representative Council of the University of Miami. And she told me, Francine, you are dreaming a dead dream. For the simple reason, at first, you're a foreign student. Second, never a woman has become president of the Student Council. And then I was sitting during the official opening of the university year. I saw the president of the Student Representative Council doing a speech. And then I touched my friend and said, listen, one day I'll be speaking like him. And she knocked me from the job. And I started doing my way and doing things that will lead me to become the president of the Student Representative Council. I joined the basketball team. I joined the choir of the University of Namibia. And then I did my internship at the radio university. So I became popular. And by becoming popular, it enabled the fellow youth, the students, to trust me and what I could do for them. So, since then, I try my best to find a way to lead me to become the president of the SLC. It's the same as today, as you sit there, you need to find a way to get things that can lead you to get where you want. And you can do all that while you are a young person. Don't dream to become a member of parliament, a president of this country, a minister, or a public servant, if you don't start now to work on it. If you don't dress like a president, don't dream to become a president. If you don't speak like a president, don't dream to become a president. When you don't have friends that can lead you to become a president, don't dream to become a president. Not even to become a member of parliament. You have to be very articulated like my brother. So it all begins now and here. Don't wait when you become, I don't want appointed and then you start acting like that. And one thing is that, in Africa, we have this disadvantage. In other parts of the world, when they see something like equality in a young person, they help you achieve. But in Africa, the more you become intelligent, the more you become a threat. The more you walk by, the more you attract enemies. And that's where the challenge of leadership comes in. As a leader, you go back like a tree. There are other trees down here. But when you get too high, the winds will always come around you because you are always very high. And that's what I'm challenges. So when we look at Africa today, yesterday I was listening to Professor Muyumba. He said some very important points on the current status of Africa. We have the African Union, created by our founding fathers to serve the interests of Africa. The question is, how strong enough are our institutions to respond to the needs of Africans? It's not about having strong individuals, but having strong institutions. So when I spoke about the four pillars of youth development, youth participation in decision making, as Honorable Temba said, you don't just turn up as voters, but you also have to turn up as candidates. We have to work hard to make sure that we kill anything that undermines the youth participation and the youth inclusion in decision making. And if we don't include young people today, there's a big danger tomorrow. So, when it comes to entrepreneurship at the African Union level, when we were advocating for youth entrepreneurship, we came up with an idea of establishing the African Youth Development Fund. Because we believe nobody can talk about entrepreneurship in Africa if we don't facilitate youth access to finance. Yes. The plans of speeches and telling young people to do entrepreneurship without facilitating possibilities for them to get access to finance, then we are wasting time. Yes. We are no longer interested to see our institutions continuing to gather young people around the Africa and coming up with resolutions that does not change the lives of the young Africans. How can decisions taken at the African Union impact the youth of Zimbabwe? How can decisions of heads of state in relation of youth can impact the young person here and each of people? And that's what we are talking about. So we were so grateful that we got so much support from African head of states to make sure that African Union could establish the African Youth Fund. But so disappointed of its implementation, which is being delayed. For no reason. Because African leaders asked the African Union Commission to establish and to facilitate operationalization of this fund as soon as possible. So we want the young people in Zimbabwe, South Africa, and probably everywhere to access the finance, to access these funds that the African Union created for young people of Africa, and to easily access the same funds without any bureaucratic system. And without any discrimination, any young person with a good project that can be funded needs to get that opportunity. And the people sitting in the African Union Commission need to know that they are serving Africa. They are not serving themselves. African Union is the people of Africa. African Union is not individuals sitting in the African Union Commission or sitting in the AU. How important do you think our institutions are? It doesn't make sense to have all these institutions if they are not impacting the lives of our people. And if these institutions cannot be able to take care of themselves, Does it make sense? Yes. If we want to respect that, let's start with some things. We take so much time deciding, and also implementing becomes a serious problem. It has been 5 years since we have been talking about the AU reform. But say, the AU has serious problems. And serious problems. How can us Africans sit through the reform of the institution 5 years without finding a solution? Without agreeing. And the moment that we are about to agree, there will be a call coming from Paris. There will be a call coming from Washington. There will be a call coming from Belgium. To interfere in our business. And this is why I'm telling you the interesting part. You mustn't allow anyone to use you in order to destroy Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe first for Zimbabweans. And no one knows Zimbabwe more than you. No one can tell you knows Zimbabwe and loves Zimbabwe more than you. So nothing need to compromise the interests of your country. Never let it happen. Never let it happen. You can compromise your own interests, but not the interests of your country.
To disturb peace and stability in Zimbabwe.
Mandora to disturb peace and stability in Zimbabwe. No matter the situation, dialogue must come first. Dialogue must come first. Perhaps there are misunderstandings. Before running actions that can bring violence, that can compromise Zimbabwe's security, first thing of the dialogue that we can all have in order to have solutions. In order to have solutions. So basically, on peace and stability, I believe that you can be capable to work together. And when you do politics, you are not enemies. I also do, maybe I don't have a politics, but I don't do politics. You are not enemies, you can talk. You can be brothers and sisters, but you can differ on some opinions. That is normal. So, when it comes to Africa and international level, youth participation in peace and security is very important. If the young people are the ones destabilizing our countries, let's bring them to the table and ask them why. Ask them why. The solution will not come from the persons representing them, but themselves as well. What is happening? So youth participation in peace and security is very important. How many young people we have in our peace missions in Africa? From the African Union, from SADC, and from all these regional organizations. We need to make sure that we have young people in these missions and they see what they're doing. When it comes to peace, I went to Somalia a few years ago and Central African Republic. When I arrived in Central African Republic, I found the serious religious problems. And they told me, if you leave Bangui, the capital city, and you go at least few meters, it's very dangerous. You can't go and talk to those young people, and they're very violent. I took my team and put my scarf and went with these young people. They were dangerous, some of them. But we wanted to know why they were. They told us that they have no access to education. Tertiary education. They have no possibility to access equality education. And they want to be educated. These are the residents, young people that we met some 2 or 3 kilometers from Bangui. The same thing we went to Somalia with AMISOM. The African force armed by sent there. We spent 3 days in the camp. And everybody, believe me, is very afraid to sleep in Somalia and Mogadishu. But we spent 3 days in the camp. We had time to talk to Somalian youth. And we understood the reason why young people need to participate in peace and security decision making. And when we talk about this, we talk about the resolution 2250, if I'm not mistaken, of the UN Security Council on Youth Peace and Stability, which we worked on, we were part of as African youth, and we made sure that it happened. So when you're advocating for the rights of Zimbabwe, as young Zimbabweans, make sure you also have time to understand the African Youth Charter. The African Youth Charter contains youth responsibilities and rights, youth political participation, economic participation, and everything you want as advocacy and anything you find in the African Youth Charter. I'm told that the African Youth Charter has already ratified in Zimbabwe. but we need to advocate for its implementation. Ratifying is one thing, signing is one thing, but implementation is the most important thing. Make sure as a youth of Zimbabwe to demand also that and to look your right in terms of the African Youth Charter. So, it has been my passion to serve the youth for the past 12 years. We have gone around the world with determination because we believe in the power of youth to change things. The most important asset of Africa's development is not our natural resources. It is not the diamond that we have in Congo. It is not the gold that we have in Congo, the gold and all these natural resources. But it's you, it's young people. This demographic dividend is the most important asset of Africa's development. Africa cannot develop without you. In Europe, people are becoming very old. It is only in Africa we have youthful people, a big number of youthful people. So this will serve Africa in helping Africa to go forward. African young people can also make change when they are surrounded by role models. When you don't have role models in your community, Honorable Professor Muyumba, it is completely impossible to ask young people to be good citizens. And that's where our leaders need to lead by example. Young people cannot fight corruption if corruption is everywhere in the country. Young people cannot be good leaders tomorrow if we don't have good leaders today in our respective countries. Forget about it. In most African countries, African youth don't have good problems. They don't have problems. There are only few. We have so much malpractices in our institutions. We have people in the public service who are very old that must meet and respect the young people. We have very bureaucratic public services in Africa. And this is the battle that we have won in Congo. What we have done with the government of Congo, we are going around the country and telling all of our parents who served our country to go and rest. Not in peace, but in rest. So this can create young people employment opportunities. And this is what we have to do in all our public sectors in Africa. Enable to bring young people out so that they can get a job. And they have to get it very well without being a child of the minister, without being a child of the governor. But all the young people should have the same rights. All of us. We don't have people that inspire us. We have most of the young people in Africa who just want to become political leaders. But most of the young people are not inspired to become good, big entrepreneurs. And this is very dangerous for Africa. Everybody wants to be a political leader. Everybody wants to get to parliament. Everybody wants to be a minister. But the country cannot only be led by politicians. The country cannot only develop by politicians. We need entrepreneurs. And this is why our people need to access finance to make sure that we promote youth entrepreneurship in our different countries. And when young people get into politics, they just become like all these school guys, Professor Muyumba. It's just like a virus that which has been transmitted from one place to another. There's no difference. I've seen some young people that used to talk in the past, but since they get positions, they become the same and they forget where they're coming from. Corrupted like no one is. So we need to overcome all these malpractices because we cannot give lessons to young people when we don't ourselves role models in our institutions. So our institutions need to lead by example. You cannot hold accountable the young people when you don't hold accountable yourself. And these are some of those big institutions that we are having around the continent and also in our countries. So I believe that from these few ideas that I've expressed here, and I think as my last time as a youth leader, it will help most of you and those that are following us. I'm not saying goodbye. I'm going to be there this year, but most of the responsibilities are being run by our Vice President, Madam Juliana, who's there. And also the rest of our Executive Committee, represented by the different countries in Africa, because each region is represented by two representatives, and we have one Secretary General. So there is one position empty for Southern Africa. And Zimbabwe must go for it. So, we'll continue working together, Honorable and Professor Muyumba, to make sure that we advance Africa and that the citizens member, our leaders, impact lives of our people on the ground. We have been talking about African passports, but we don't know why the passport is delayed. Everyone must have it, including a student in Zimbabwe. So that we can promote integration. A young person from Zimbabwe can go to Cairo without having any problem. A young person from Zimbabwe can go anywhere in Africa without having any problem. And this is for all Africans. So we need to break all these barriers and break all these borders that were put in place by our colonizers, not by ourselves. We are one people, and we need to promote Pan-Africanism in living together and make sure that when I sleep in peace in Congo, in Zimbabwe also my brothers and sisters must be in peace. And this is what the Kwame Nkrumah fought for, the Patrice Lumumba, and all the leaders of Africa fought for. They did not fight to create an African Union that is being manipulated and pushed all over to serve the interests of other people and non-governments. This is not what they want. They did not fight for an Africa that sits there to represent the manipulation that comes from all over. So we believe that we can never be afraid in raising our voices to protect Africa's interests and also the interests of our countries. Accept to fail intelligently than win stupidly. Don't succeed as a stupid person. Better you fail as a very intelligent person than to succeed as a stupid person. I don't accept injustices because I have to succeed. Stupid. But I accept to sit because I need to protect my values. So in short, nothing wrong because I've been speaking for quite a long time. I just want to thank my brother for inviting us. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Muyumba, for listening to us. Thank you, my sisters and my brothers, and all of you that have come from all over Zimbabwe. Thank you very much.
Generation in the southern region, youthful, which will sell out the next example?
No.
Yes, sir.
No. That I can tell you, the current generation will not sell out. They don't have time to sell out. The ideology of the founding fathers remains the same. The ideology of the struggle of Zimbabwe remains the same. And we are better to be the ambassadors for that. And there must be, you know, smiling, seeing good work which is being done right now. What I want to say to you today, and you are here, Professor, you are here, Ambassador, the national dialogue which has been called upon in the country, and there are various parties that are meeting. Today we call it a caucus. The real dialogue is with the youth are invited to the table. The real dialogue is when the youth are invited to the table. Right now they are focusing. When your mother and father are in the bedroom talking, when they now are ready for the meeting, they call everyone. So let's allow them to focus. The church leaders focus. The political parties focus. It's a focus. It's not yet a dialogue. They will know that a dialogue will not happen in Zimbabwe until the youth who are 70% are involved. And the youth who are independent, the youth who are fair, not the youth where we believe that the ruling party is the youth, the biggest opposition is the youth. The majority of the youth in this country don't belong to parties. Yes. Who is representing them? Who is representing them? So that's what it is. Professor Muyumba, Ambassador, I would like to the President of the Republic of Zimbabwe. To say, President, you don't have ministers at all. It is embarrassing that when the youth are gathered to listen to the ministers, they are cabinet ministers, they are deputy ministers, they are permanent secretaries. They decide not to be here. Who are they saying? Who are they saying? When we are the representatives of the AU, here, I'll tell you that there will be giant passion come 2020 election. There will be giant passion come 2020.
That the youth who are progressive must be part.
who do they trust? We don't want people who are compromised. We want people who understand the aspiration of youth. From the child council, who is there? From the other parliamentarians, who is there? Let me take this opportunity to invite the Minister of Higher Potential Education. He's probably one of the most professional ministers. He has invited Mr. Mutete, who is the director for policy formulation, to just speak while the ambassador is here before she leaves his speech. It's a 5-minute speech, and with that, then we'll be able to invite Professor Muyumba to come and speak. Thank you. Okay, Ambassador will be leaving soon, so this is a 5-minute speech, and then she will not have a photo shoot with the young, with the youth here, and so forth. So take that opportunity before she leaves. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Honorable Mliswa, who is the Commander-in-Chief of the Army, Professor Muyumba, Honorable Muyumba, Ambassador Muyumba, Juliana. Let me say myself, I say all protocols are there. My minister, Professor Amon Korea, is out of the commissioner of duty. So we assigned initially the human secretary to come and address you, but again, he's held up. So they eventually delegated me to come and deliver the speech. It's very fortunate for me because I'm a youth pastor. So I was a teacher for 30 years in high school. I enjoy seeing students and young people. And being a youth pastor at your church, I enjoy every time when I meet the young people. So let me go to the speech. I was thrilled by the theme itself, by the first wave. As a physics teacher, I understand what the waves are. A wave simply means propagation of energy. It starts somewhere, it goes on and on and on. So whatever will happen here, it starts with you, then it goes on and on and on. Ladies and gentlemen, we are gathered here for a very important special event on our calendar as well, in the Ministry of Higher Education, Science and Technology Development. And I want to express my sincere gratitude and to mention that I have been humbled by the solid invitation to be part of this event, and also to be afforded an opportunity to present something on this event of national, regional, and global bearing. Let me also say that I'm humbled by your level of organizational ability, where you've managed to host such an important event with important people from across nations. Now, our ministry is the Ministry of Higher Education. It's not a vision which is covalently bonded with the national vision of industrialization and modernization, where Zimbabwe will become an upper middle income economy by 2030, as enunciated by His Excellency the President of Zimbabwe Government in Indaba. As a ministry, we are also striving to create the Zimbabwe that we all want. We also want to create the Africa that we all want. The Zimbabwe and Africa that is free of violence, free of hate, free of corruption, free of poverty, and free of preventable and preventive diseases, through the establishment of an educational superstructure that transfigures knowledge into goods and services. Now, in all this, our guiding philosophy in the quest to transform our higher and tertiary education institutions to be responsive to the growing needs of the job market and entrepreneurship, and to achieve tenets of organization and industrialization is of heritage-based development with a programmatic approach to business. Now let me pause a little bit to explain what we mean by heritage-based education. Many people, when they hear the word heritage, they think of the shashi or the mapa and all things like that. When we talk of heritage-based education, we are simply referring to education that is based on what we have. What do we have in Zimbabwe? We have minerals, so our education must be focused on minerals. How do we best derive from the minerals? What also do we have? We have natural resources. So our education must be helpful. In other words, we want to perfect the skills of working with those resources. We cannot help our institution teaching about snow technology when we know that we could have snow in this country. That cannot be our focus. So in all these things, we are establishing a synchronized infrastructure, such as programs infrastructure, synchronized student bodies, physical infrastructure, financing infrastructure that will increase access to higher learning and thus reducing university or college dropout. Modern infrastructure for technology is a priority, where learning and living spaces for students will create the best conditions for exporting higher and tertiary education products that we will be proud of. We all intend to work together towards rebuilding our economies through the development of critical skills in all the sectors of our economy. The national skills audit that was conducted by this ministry also showed that though we boast of a 95% literacy rate, the skills availability is less than 40%. I got a document for that effect. You can take a look at it. Which means that there is need to realign our higher national education system from the traditional three mission institutions, where we are focusing on teaching, community service, and research. So we've added two more missions to our universities and colleges to say, let us teach, let us do consultancy or community service, let us do research, and then we have to be innovative and industrialized. You also appreciate, ladies and gentlemen, that to realize our mission, the ministry has come up with the concept of innovation hubs. Now, these innovation hubs, if it is used, it's not only for users, it's for everyone, for researchers, for academics, for anyone who wants to research, it's in their disposal. So we are establishing those, and that should be embraced by all universities. So far, 16 universities have been targeted as the pilot project, and the University of Zimbabwe is among them. Well, construction of the innovation hub is now almost 95% complete. Those who come from around that area, they are going to move now. Now, our ministry is guided by policy, programs, priorities in the execution of our mandate. We want to develop an inclusive financial education system that is rooted in heritage and culture, as I say, facilitating also learning development through provision of adequate infrastructure for students. And we also want to develop and uphold a healthy higher national education ecosystem where institutions stick to their mandates. Of late, institutions were diverting from their mandates, their commercial school, they were diverting to other things. So we are now working towards realigning and making sure that every university is sticking to their mandate. Now, to achieve all these priority areas, We have lined up programs, some of them have been completed. We have conducted the national fiscal skills project. It is done as commissioned. It was launched. There's also the geospatial aeronautical and space science that are built for Zimbabwe that will assist farmers and the Ministry of Mines, where we can locate every mine and we can determine which minerals are in this area, which type of soil is in this area, so that we come out to put in our farming and mining activities. Then we also want to adopt and develop life technologies. We want to improve the quality of life for people through an organization called IT, where we do research on genetics. Actually, the program is known as genomics. I'm not sure if it's genomics, but it's doing that so that we can improve life of the people who are sick, the research on diseases, research on the ARVs, research on the people with HIV, and prolong the life of the people of Zimbabwe. We also have the high performance computing city, the UC, which is the HPC, which is again open for researchers and academics. It's also one of our programs that we are working on. We've got the cold fuel research program that is also being undertaken by our ministry. We are also capacitating teachers in the teaching of science, where we have noted that the teachers of science are in short supply. So we are capacitating teachers who are already there to be able to teach science and mathematics. That is done at Mliswa Teachers College. We have established a center there. We also are in the process of constructing new universities. One of the university, Marondera, Mani International University, and the Pan African Minerals University, which is known as PAMF. We want to construct state-of-the-art equipment and the infrastructure so that research can be done effectively. In conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, let me mention that the Ministry of Higher Education, we are guided by our philosophy, where we design our programs in a good approach to do our day-to-day business. And as the minister, we look at the unseen, and we see the unseen. We will create jobs that today have no names. For instance, when we were born in the 70s, there was nothing like a network administrator, but now we have those things. So we are also trying to work toward the creation of jobs which have gone up today. According to the ambassador, he says she raises stupidity. We are also working to do our stupidity in young people by providing quality education. In these few ways, let me thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you very much, thank you. The Minister of Higher Tertiary Education is one of the most proactive ministers. He's realized that he needs to change the entire approach to education, higher tertiary skills, unfortunately, and we need to really double up. We have also invested in oil, we've got an oil line, and we'd like to turn the oil into oil. From a scientific point of view, students, and also welcome to this mission.